right, salaam alaikum guys. So we're going to go ahead and start inshallah ta'ala with the next juz. So I'll give you guys a minute to get logged on inshallah. So while you guys are getting logged on, I'll give you guys just a little cool tidbit about Sūrat al-Aʻrāf. Edgar Allan Poe, the great American poet, his longest poem was actually called al-Aʻrāf. So he actually wrote a poem in the 1800s, al-Aʻrāf, and it's his most famous poem, or his longest poem, not his most famous one. But it's not obviously true to the Qur'an, and per se, it's not a theological poem, but it's pretty interesting that he based his longest poem off of Surat al-A'raf. So also just to let you guys know, so we'll go ahead and start inshallah. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi man wala. So the Edgar Allan Poe part was not tafsir, but Surat al-A'raf is named Surat al-A'raf. Obviously it refers to that barrier, you know, or this, the heights. Al-A'raf means the heights. It refers to this barrier between the people of hellfire and the people of paradise, and there are a group of people, subhanAllah, that are standing on that barrier on the day of judgment, on an A'raf, and their good deeds and their bad deeds are completely equal. You can imagine, subhanAllah, the value of one hasana, the value of one good deed at that time, they are completely equal. So their good deeds and bad deeds are completely equal. They're standing on al-A'raf and they're seeing the people of paradise enter into paradise, and they're wishing them well and making dua for them. And they're seeing the people of hellfire and they're making dua that they're not amongst them. And they're condemning the people of hellfire as they're entering into hellfire. And eventually Allah's mercy overtakes them and they enter into paradise. So al-A'raf is that partition, right? That barrier, because again, it's the consequence now that Allah is mentioning to the rejection of Surat al-An'am. Where you have the people that have now chosen to go in their directions, and so the people of paradise have entered in their way, and the people of hellfire have entered into their way. So the next juz 9, which is from Surat al-A'raf verse 88 to Surat al-Anfal verse 40. So we're going to have two surahs also covered partially within juz 9, verse 88 Surat al-A'raf to Surat al-Anfal verse 40. There's a very powerful verse that comes pretty much in the beginning of this juz. If you remember in the previous surah, in Surat al-An'am, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَمَّا نَسُوا مَا ذُكِّرُوا بِهِ فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَبْوَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى إِذَا فَرِحُوا بِمَا أُوتُوا أَخَذْنَاهُمْ بَغْتَةً فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْلِسُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surat al-An'am, the previous surah, that when, you know, that whenever they insisted on turning away from the guidance that came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah mentions, we opened for them every door of good that they wanted in this world. So this is actually talking about the worldly consequence here, that we gave them what they wanted of this world. They were able to enjoy the wealth of this world and enjoy, you know, the different blessings of this world. Hatta idha farihu bima utu, but then once they became too excited and overjoyed with what they had, either those things lost luster with them, so they, you know, they realized that those things were not fulfilling, that living in that lust was not actually going to give them what they wanted, or أَخَذْنَاهُمْ بَغْتَ, they were taken by death, فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْلِسُونَ, and left in complete despair. That's in Surat al-An'am. In Surat al-A'raf, verse 96, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ أَنَّ أَهْلَ الْقُرَىٰ آمَنُوا وَتَقُوا. Remember, this is talking about the post now, right? This is consequence and circumstance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if only the people of the cities, these various towns that disobeyed their prophets and disbelieved in their prophets, had they believed and feared their Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَفَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ بَرَكَاتٍ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. We would have given them barakah, we would have given them blessings from the heavens and from the earth, but instead Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, instead they refused, and so they were seized, بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ, as a result of that which they earned. So it's like, subhanAllah, it's completely connected to the previous verse. The only word that's been added is barakah, that there would have been blessing in their wealth, there would have been blessing in their health, there would have been blessing in their career pursuits, blessings falling upon it from the skies, blessing in their crops, and so on and so forth. But instead, because they insisted on turning away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they insisted upon that path of misguidance, they had no blessing in anything that was opened, any door that was opened to them in this dunya. So this is Surah Al-A'raf and Surah Al-An'am. Within just these two verses, we can see how these surahs are actually very closely related to one another. In verse 101, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, tilka al-qura, that these are the cities, all of these different towns and cities that turned away from their prophets. Naqussu alayka min anba'iha. And we relate these to you, O Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We relate these stories to you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, so that you can know of their news and the things that happened to them. And basically that their prophets, their messengers came to them with proofs. They came to them with everything that you're coming to them with now. فَمَا كَانُوا لِيُؤْمِنُوا. And they would not be able to believe because بِمَا كَذَّبُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ. They were not to believe in that which they had denied before. كَذَلِكَ يَطْبَعُ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِ الْكَافِرِينَ. And like that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala seals the hearts of those who reject. So the idea here is that they've turned away. No matter what proofs are being sent to them now, they're turning away. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, look at all of these cities and these examples that I've just given you, Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is how the hearts are sealed. When they insist upon turning away from God, this is how the hearts are sealed. However, there's always targhib and tarhib. There's always good news and bad news. There's always hope and fear, and they come together. The next part of the surah, of Surah Al-A'raf, actually transitions to the story of Musa and Fir'aun. But particularly Musa alayhi salam with the magicians that would believe in him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the story of Moses, peace be upon him, with the staff and the magicians of Pharaoh, the sahara of Fir'aun, and their staffs, right? And each of them coming together for this long bout in which they would be told to cast their staffs. And this was something that would in the eyes of Fir'aun, that would crush the da'wah of Musa alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just told Musa alayhi salam to go forth and do what you're told, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make something great happen of it. So what happens with Musa alayhi salam is he comes to this gathering with the magicians of Fir'aun, with the sahara of Fir'aun, and we know the story that the sahara of Fir'aun, the magicians of Pharaoh, throw their staffs first, and all of those staffs become snakes in the form of an optical illusion. So they all appear to be snakes. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands Musa alayhi salam to throw his staff. And when Musa alayhi salam throws his staff, it becomes a snake and it eats all of their snakes. So what happens? All of the magicians of Fir'aun believe in Musa alayhi salam. They make sajdah and they say, Amanna bi Rabbi Musa, that we believe in the Lord of the worlds, the Lord of Musa and the Lord of Harun. So they came back to believe in Musa alayhi salam. And they came back to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the same magic that they were putting forth, right, actually came back to be a proof against them. But they accepted guidance. And this is a bushra, a glad tidings of sorts to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that there will always be believers that will sincerely see the truth and they will seek it out and they will come to you. And many times, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُؤَيِّدُ هَذَا الدِّينَ بِالرَّجُلِ الْفَاجِرِ. Many times, Allah gives aid to this religion through a wicked person trying to do it harm. So in the case of Pharaoh and his magicians, they were trying to detract from the da'wah of Musa alayhi salam, but they actually gave the da'wah of Musa alayhi salam more credibility because now the magicians themselves had accepted the religion of Moses. Now they also accepted Islam. So you have a really, really interesting dynamic playing out here. And this is what happened in Mecca. Every time they tried to suppress the message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Allah amplified it. And that's what happened with Fir'aun and Musa. And so Allah is telling the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam that such will happen to you. But again, this is now the end of Surah Al-A'raf. And this is the last words to the people of Mecca, the consequences. So Allah mentions the threats of Fir'aun, the threats of the Pharaoh towards his people that believed. And he threatened them with persecution because he didn't have an argument to make anymore. It really was just persecution. The language of the oppressors and the rejectors has always been persecution. It has not been reason. It has not been rational, trying to rationalize anything. It has not been civilized discussion or discourse. It's always persecution. So the people of Mecca were taking a page out of the book of Fir'aun. right? And we have a Pharaoh, and or the Pharaoh of this ummah is Abu Jahl, who persecuted the Prophet ﷺ, who tried to suppress the Prophet ﷺ, and who tried to suppress the message. But instead, the message would grow, and even his own household would eventually accept Islam. Just like in the case of Fir'aun, his own household would eventually accept Islam. Right? So just like Asiya comes from the house of Fir'aun, Ikramah, the son of Abu Jahl, would become one of the greatest Muslims. Right? So the children of these people, and the family members of these people, would also see the truth, and there was no way to fully suppress the truth. And that's the message that's being given here, that despite the threats of Fir'aun, the believers escape persecution, despite the threats of the people of the Prophet ﷺ, of Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab and so on and so forth, the believers would escape persecution. And so subhanAllah, look at this transition now. Surah al-A'raf now transitions to